Hey guys, great to be here this morning, and I'm glad you're here. And we often talk about how many people are or who's not here and how few people are here and all that. But guys, we thank God for you being here and making it your business to press out, all right? So hey, so every man in this place, every one of us knows what it is. If you are a Christian man, okay? You are a Christian man, that is a man who has received the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior, as Lord of your life. You are a Christian. You've trusted Him. He saved you. You are a Christian. And listen, guys, Bible study does not a Christian make. Right? All of these good things, don't get the idea that you are a Christian because of this or that. The thing that makes a man a Christian is that they have surrendered their hearts and lives to the Lord Jesus, the Lordship of Christ. They've received Him as Savior. And the good news is he will receive anyone who comes. So nobody's disqualified. The only ones who can't come are those who won't come. That sounds a little strange, right? If you won't come, you can't come. And but if you are a Christian man, there has been a place, a time when you have trusted, like Paul says, I know whom I've believed. I know whom I've believed. I am absolutely persuaded that He is able to keep that which I've committed unto Him. You've come and you've received Him, you've believed Him, right? That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus and shalt believe in thine heart that God has raised Him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. To believe on Jesus means to unbelieve on yourself. Right? When you believe in Jesus, that means you turn away from your own activity, ability, nobility, all the things that you might have trusted in your own workaday idea of salvation. You turn away from that, knowing that you have nothing in yourself whereby you might commend yourself to God. No matter how good a husband, man, citizen, son, neighbor you fancy yourself to be, you must turn away from trusting yourself. That's why often when we are sharing the gospel with people, one of the most difficult things is getting people not saved but lost, because the average person don't know they're lost. They think, I'm okay, you okay, I'm not as bad as my neighbor, and I certainly hadn't done that, and I've been a good husband, and I raised all my youngins, and I've been down at the mill for 45 years. I mean, just begin to commend themselves. And so I asked a question. If you were to die today, are you 100% sure that heaven is your home? Yes. And you kind of see, just like once in my life, or you sort of a faraway look and sort of the mental posturing and reckoning. You say, well, I believe I go to heaven. And then here's the diagnostic question. Why? Tell me why. I call it a diagnostic question because when a man says he believes he's going to heaven and you ask him why, whatever he says next tells you what he's believing in. When he begins to say, well, I've done this, I'm this, I'm that, I'm the other thing, that shows you that his trust really is in himself. So I'm not trying to give you the right answers to the quiz. I'm simply trying to show you that if that's your answer, well, I've tried to do right by people. Mama and them raised me right. You know, I don't have any enemies that I know of. I've always done this, I've always done that. And that's basically where it all usually falls down. It's all I'm trusting in what I have done or what I am doing or what I don't do. And it's sort of a comparison Christianity where compared to other people, I guess I'm not at the front of the pack, but I'm not at the bottom. I'm sort of in this, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I'm in that 80 percentile. You know, and the Bible teaches exactly the opposite of trusting yourself. It means looking away from yourself and looking to Jesus Christ, the only Savior. Neither is there salvation in any other. Now, this is narrow. This is narrow. But this is what Peter said. Peter said, neither is there salvation in any other. For there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. No other name. You say, well, what about the people here that for there's none other name? If the Bible is true, we believe the Bible makes us seem like we're very narrow, bigoted people, but the truth is narrow, you see? Everything ain't right. And if something is right, that means something else is wrong. We have to come to grips with that. Everything can't be right. And if 2 plus 2 is 4, then it can't be 3.9 or 4.1 or 17. If 4 is right, then 3.9 is wrong. 4.1 is wrong. 17 is wrong. So if there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved, and he's talking about the name of Jesus Christ, that name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, every tongue should confess, of things in heaven and earth and under the earth, right, to the glory of God the Father. This is the name that the tongues are going to confess. Right? The Buddhist tongue is going to have to confess it. Right? The Muslim tongue is going to have to confess it. The Baptist tongue is going to have to confess it. The Catholic tongue is going to have to confess it. All these labels we put on, every tongue has to confess. Every knee. Right? Yeah, the atheist tongue is going to confess. So that's, you say that's narrow, but that's how truth is. Have you noticed that? In mathematics, you don't say, well, that's 4. I just can't. That's too narrow. I mean, you mean all these other numbers in the world. You're telling me 4 has got to be the one? Come on now. That doesn't seem right, that 4. It can only be 4. You don't do that with math. Right? You don't do that with medicine. I got a headache. Give me some Bengay. That don't work on headaches. You know what I'm saying? I got a headache. Give me some Preparation H. One guy said, man, he said, no, I don't use Preparation H. He says, I tried it one time. That stuff tastes awful. But there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. So have you come to that place where you have looked to Jesus and looked away from yourself and looked away from your abilities, nobilities, activities, all of these things, and looked to Jesus? I was in a Bible study on Wednesday, and one of the gentlemen asked, he says, why is it so, he was talking to a lady in this church, and she was upset with him because he was trying to explain this very thing, that many times we give an inadequate gospel because people don't know how bad off they are. They don't know how dire their situation is. Like, I'm a pretty good old boy. So they don't have a sense of desperation. And so then if you don't know how bad the bad news is, you won't appreciate how good the good news is. It's right? It's the bad news that makes the good news good news. And if you don't understand the bad news, which is I am a sinner, guilty before a holy God, doomed and damned apart from Jesus Christ, you just kind of breeze through this life. I'm okay, you okay, we're all okay. And I ain't as bad as others, so I'll make it in. It just ain't so. So you've come to this place in your life, convicted by the Holy Spirit of God, that you are a sinner in word, in thought, in deed. Don't deny the truth. You know this. You know this. You are a sinner in word, in thought, and deed. A sinner by birth and a sinner by behavior. Sinners. And God doesn't just wink his eye at sin. It's egregious to a holy God. And if you don't think sin is egregious, then we hadn't captured a picture of Jesus, a mental picture of Jesus upon the cross writhing in agony because of sin. And not only what we could see in our minds, what man did to him, what my sin caused, but not only that, the travail of his soul as the Father poured out the wrath of God upon my sin in Jesus. I mean, if I could somehow get to heaven by my own righteousness, then Calvary was a mistake. If there was some other way, when Jesus said, Father, there be any other way, let this cup, the bitter dregs of this cup, pass from me, the silence from heaven suggests there is no other way. So a person comes to the Lord Jesus Christ, acknowledging their sin. Let God be true, every man a liar. God says, I'm a sinner. Don't spend your time defending yourself against God. You confess, you agree with God. Don't defend yourself against God. You agree with God against yourself. Amen. God, you say, I'm a sinner. I am a sinner, and I know I am in word and thought and deed. I'm guilty. I'm a guilty sinner before a holy, holy, holy God. And my relative righteousness might cut it with old John over there. You know, I'm not this, I'm not that. And me and old John, that's a relative righteousness, but it will not cut it before a holy God. So have you come to that place where you have been honest with yourself, honest with God, that I need a Savior? Now, if you don't think you need a Savior, you won't look to a Savior. If you think you can somehow navigate and you can somehow by your own means negotiate the terms of your surrender, you're never going to know what it is to be saved, because Jesus is your Savior. You need a Savior. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a what? But you know why a Savior? Because that's what all men need. He didn't say born unto you this day in the city of David an accountant. Right? How many accountants in here? You don't need another Don, all right? Believe me, the world does not need one more. Listen. Not a plumber, not a doctor, not a But a what? Why that description? Why that description? Because that's what all men need, is a Savior. And even Mary, who birthed him, acknowledged that she was giving birth to her Savior. You know, Mary knew she needed a Savior. So the Holy Spirit of God, listen, if there is conviction in your heart this morning already about this, that, hey, if I die and I'll step out into a godless eternity, eternity estranged from the God who, watch this now, who loved me and wants me and gave his son for me, and I stiff arm him and say no, and God has commanded all men everywhere to repent. There is a day of judgment that he has appointed by Jesus Christ. You say, well, how do you know that's going to happen? God has proved it because God raised him from the dead. That's what Paul said when he was preaching on Mars Hill. The resurrection is proof that God is going to raise, or God is going to judge the world by Jesus Christ, whom he raised from the dead. So I would say to any man in here, if there's conviction in your heart that I need a Savior, that's the Holy Spirit of God doing that. Don't say no to him. Don't you stiff arm him. Don't you just say, well, you know, if I could just get away from that, you know, who invited me here? Man, if I could just somehow get out of here today, I'd be okay. Right? Because that's how people act, like as if I'm putting on some pressure to you to make some. If you feel pressure, you feel a sense of there's something I need to do. Listen, that's the Holy Spirit of God. I'm not trying to guilt you into anything or talk you into anything, because if I talk you into it, somebody else can talk you out of it. I'm not. But the pressure is the Holy Spirit of God speaking to your heart about your never dying soul and your need of a Savior. And hallelujah, we have a Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. And if you look to him in faith, he'll save you. Now, those of us who've trusted Jesus Christ as our Savior, Christian men, doesn't mean that we're sinless. It certainly ought to mean that we sin less. Right? As I walk with the Lord, as the Holy Spirit of God is working in my heart and in my life, and I fall deeper and deeper in love with Jesus, the more I know about him, the more I learn about myself. And the more I learn about myself, I give all I know to all I know of him. Right? And then the more I give myself to the one I know and the one who loves me, the more he shows himself to me. And the more he shows himself to me, the more I see of myself. And the more I see of myself, the more I know I need to give to him. And the more I give to him, the more he shows of himself. And the more he shows of himself, the more he shows me myself. You know how that works? It's just. And that's exactly right. And I'm moving more and more into his likeness. This process, we call it sanctification process, where God is doing that work. And the same God who saves us is the one who has to sanctify us now. But I have to cooperate. And this is why I want to talk a little bit about in just this next couple of minutes. So, you know, as we as believers, you know, what is public enemy number one? What is man's great problem? Sin. I don't care what form it comes out in. Sin is my problem. It is our native problem. Sin. And when we get saved, doesn't mean sin is eradicated and the flesh is eradicated. It means that the Holy Spirit of God has been given to me to help me to live apart beyond and above the old tendencies of yesterday. And listen, he is this very present help. Yep. This is the Holy Spirit, the very present help. This is Christ in us. And so we recognize that sin is the big problem. As I look across the world, I know the problem with the world is sin. If you don't understand the sin principle, you're not going to understand yourself. You're not going to understand your children, your wife, the world around you, if you don't understand the sin principle. We're all selfish and want what we want. And it drips out in the faucet as all these isms, whether it's racism or sexism or this or that or the other thing, but it's all men wanting their way. My old sinful self, right? So, well, what about it as Christians? What about sin in the life of a believer? Right? Are we forgiven or not? Sometimes we say, you know, you need to confess your sins. If you confess your sins, he's faithful and just to do what? Forgive you of your sin and to what? Cleanse you from all unrighteousness. You say, but I thought I've already been forgiven. I'm a Christian. Yeah, you have already been forgiven. Now, listen, there's two kinds of forgiveness in the Bible. Okay? Watch this. There is what we might call a judicial forgiveness. Judicial forgiveness means that legally I am forgiven and I have a different classification. I am no longer now a sinner by classification. Once I became a Christian, I became a son of God by classification. My classification is not a sinner no more. I'm a son. I have been forgiven. Now this is gospel news. This is good news. Past, present, future. Judicial forgiveness. Jesus Christ's blood atones for my sins. Past, present, future. In the judicial sense. Therefore, the Bible says, Romans 8:1, this is where Romans 8:1 fits. There is therefore now no what? Condemnation to them that are what? Who walk not after the flesh, but after the what? Those who are saved are in Christ, and there is or will never be any, watch this now, judicial judgment. Legal judgment against our sin. I will not go to hell because of my sin. You say, wait a minute now. You say, well, how is that? Let me show you what Paul said. Turn over to Romans chapter number 4. When he's talking about salvation, okay? Paul is talking about salvation. And he's talking about how salvation comes by grace. Romans chapter number 4. All right? And he's talking about how God saves us. Right? But notice, and we're saved by faith, right? But notice here in verse number, in chapter Romans chapter number 4, verse number 1. He says, what shall we say then? That Abraham our father, as pertained to the flesh, hath found. All right? Abraham, like the father of the Jews. For if Abraham were justified or saved, that's what the word justify means. Right? If he were declared righteous, that's salvation. When you got saved, you were declared righteous judicially. And by the way, not just not guilty, but righteous. The very righteousness of Jesus is placed on the believer. 2 Corinthians 5:21, God made him to be sin for us. Just like my sin was placed on him, his righteousness was placed on me. So now watch. For if Abraham were declared righteous by works, he has whereof to glory, but not before God. In other words, if Abraham would have worked himself righteous before God, Abraham could swag. Abraham could boast. Abraham could be proud. He made it in because he was such a good guy. But then Paul says right here, not before God. It's not how it works. Listen to what he says. For what does the scripture say? Or what says the scripture? Abraham what? Believed God, and it was what? Counted unto him for righteousness. Now that's Genesis 15, where Abraham simply believed God, took God at his word, and God placed on Abraham's account righteousness. So judicially, Abraham became a righteous man because he placed faith in Jehovah God. Now, Paul is making a point here. He said, how is anybody saved? Are we saved through our works? Are we saved because you go to Sunday school, because you go to church, because you've been a good husband, because you've never done this? Are you saved that way? No, no, no. You're saved the same way Abraham was saved. You believe God, and God, the old King James word, imputes it or charges it, puts it on your account as righteousness. So like the old account was, we sang the song, the old account was settled what? Long ago. The old account was settled long ago. Now notice what he says. Now he goes on. It's good here. Okay. Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned of grace, but of debt. In other words, if you could work for it, then heaven would be a reward and not a gift. How many of y'all know heaven is not a reward for the righteous, but it is a gift to the guilty? So nobody can say, okay, God, I deserve to be here. I did this, that, and the other thing. Now, where's my reward? Who can stand before God and say that? No, no, no. We'll all receive eternal life, or all have received eternal life as a what? Gift. Now, what's the qualification of a gift? You can't earn it, or else it's not a gift. If you could earn it, if your merit got it, then it's wages. It's not a gift. That's why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is what? But the gift of God is what? The opposite things, right? One is life, one is death, one is wages, and one is a gift. Wages is what you deserve. It's what you work for. It's what you earn. Hopefully, if this payday Friday, you're going to get your wages. Suppose your boss says, well, you've been here 60 hours this week. Here's your gift. There ain't no gift. I work for that, right? That's what wages are. But if someone breaks out and gives you something you didn't earn, you realize that's a gift. And it's not because I've been good, but because he's good. So he says this, but to him that does not work, but believe on him that declares righteous the ungodly, his faith is counted as what? Does this bore y'all? This is the Bible now. He's showing us how we are righteous before God. Not through how well we behave, but in who we believe. But now what you believe determines how you behave. You do know that, right? But listen, here's what he says now. Listen to what this is my point. Verse number 6. Even as David describes the blessedness. Oh, the blessedness. Blessedness is a wonderful thing. You know what that is? That's just the well-being of life, the kiss of God, the smile of God, the goodness of God. That's blessedness. David describes the blessedness of the man. Now listen to this. Unto whom the Lord what? Credits righteousness. Does not impute what? Sin. In other words, when a person gets to be saved, when we are saved because we've trusted Jesus Christ, did you know that sin doesn't even go on your account? You know how blessed that is, how blessed we are, that sins don't even go on our account. That's what David says. The blessedness of a man to whom the Lord does not charge sin. Doesn't even put it on our account. You know why? The account is settled judicially. I don't stand before God in my sin as a sinner in jeopardy of going to hell forever. I am saved. I have the salvation of the Lord. And by the way, salvation is not probation. You know what probation is? You're free to the next time you mess up and it's back to the slammer. This is salvation. Now I'm talking to Christian men now. Christian people. He talks about the blessedness of the man to whom the Lord doesn't even put sin on our account. That's gospel stuff there. That's good news there. By the way, David says that over in Psalm 32. God gives me righteousness and does not put sin on my account. He puts righteousness on my account, which I don't deserve, and he doesn't put sin on my account, which I do deserve. Guys, I want you to get this. This is huge. That's why Paul could say, there is therefore now no condemnation, because sin doesn't even go on our account judicially. So now watch. Judicially, legally, the account is settled. Paid in full, Jesus said. Tetelestai. What's the three English word? It is finished. It is finished, Jesus said. John 19:30. It is finished. That means paid in full. The account is settled. Right? Stamp that thing. There ain't no more payment to be made. I paid it. So the account is closed. I am a son of God. I am a child of God. That's gospel. That's good news. So you say, well, what about when I lie? What about when I've done this or I've done that? I've done the other thing. Very good questions, because we have to realize now, we don't just sort of make peace with sin. May God in heaven help me never to make peace with my sin. Be okay with my junk. As a child of God, may we never make peace with our sin. I don't want to make peace with the fact that I lie. And I'm good with that. That I lust. And I'm good with that. That I'm selfish. And I'm good with that. That I don't really like people of another race. And I'm good with that. I don't want to make peace with my sin. Right? So what about sin in my life? Every thought is not a noble thought. Every deed is not done with the glory of God in mind. Every commandment has not been followed perfectly or sometime at all. What about sin in my life? If it doesn't go on my account, how is that? How is the Bible says, confess your sins and he will forgive you? I thought you just said we are already forgiven. Because, see, there is a forgiveness in the judicial sense, but there's also forgiveness in the parental sense. As believers now, we are sons of God. Behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the what? Sons and daughters of God, the children of God. We're God's children. We're not sinners, we're sons. And so the count is closed legally. But we stand now not as sinners before a judge. We stand now as children before a father. Do you understand that? So that now I don't confess my sin because I'm afraid I'm going to die and go to hell. But I confess my sin so that I can stay in fellowship with my father. That's good news. That's what the Bible talks about over in 1 John. If we confess our sins, he is what? Faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all the right. It's all about fellowship with the Father. Not being squeaky clean before a judge. You couldn't stand before this judge. The judgment of God has been taken off of you because the righteousness of Christ has been placed on you. And there is therefore now no condemnation. Your sins are forgiven, past, present, and future, in a legal sense. But in a parental sense, before the Father, I need to make sure that I'm dealing honestly with sins in my life so that I can maintain fellowship. Do you follow me? So the good thing is for the believer that there is therefore now no judgment, no condemnation. But for the child of God who is growing and wants fellowship, he understands that sin is public enemy number one, and it wears against the fellowship between me and my Father. So that I need to, if I'm going to be walking in fellowship, I need to be confessing my sins. And when I confess my sins, he is always faithful and just to what? Forgive me of my sins and to what? Cleanse me of all unrighteousness. So that they're safe. And it's illustrated beautifully. And I don't have the time. We'll look at it next week. But it's illustrated beautifully in John chapter number 13. You remember John chapter number 13 where Jesus is washing the disciples' feet? You remember that? And he's, right? He comes to Peter. What did Peter say? You will never wash my feet. Remember that? And Jesus says, okay, well, if I wash your feet, you can't have part with me. Partnership, fellowship, koinonia. Jesus didn't stand there and argue with him. Oh, yes, I am going to wash your feet too. Oh, yeah. Jesus didn't put him in a headlock. Jesus didn't, right? If Peter says, okay, you're not, watch this now. Peter says, you're not going to do it. Jesus says, okay. You don't have part in what I'm doing, right? Then Peter, in typical Peter fashion, says what? Oh, by the way, Jesus says, I know you don't understand it, Peter. And that's so much Peter didn't understand. That didn't keep Peter from talking, though. Right? He's like me. The Bible says they were up in the mountain and he said, let's build a tabernacle up here. The Bible says he said that because he didn't know what to say. But that didn't keep him from saying something. But that's just how Peter was. And Jesus says, I know you don't understand it now. You're going to understand it. But Peter says, okay, Lord, not just my feet then. If it means fellowship, if it means having part, if it means walking with you, wash my hands and my head and wash me all over. And Jesus said, wait a minute now, Peter. Yeah, pump your brakes. Pump your brakes. And then Jesus explains this. He says, if a person has already been bathed all over, he's clean. Except for his what? Feet. You don't need a whole bath, Peter, but you do need your feet to be continually what? Clean. You know what this illustrates? How saved people bathed in the blood of Jesus walk in a dirty world, walk in filthy places, and your feet are going to get dirty. They just are. Every thought's not going to be a noble thought. Every deed's not going to be a noble deed. So we walk through and you look down. Hey, if every one of us are honest and you lay in your bed tonight, you can think about the dirt of the day. Doesn't mean you're not a Christian. Doesn't mean that a man is not saved. But you look down at your feet. You say, you know what? My feet are dirty. In word, thought, deed, attitude, disposition. You look down. You say, good night. Good night. Look at my feet. And so now watch this. Who must wash our feet? The Lord. He didn't say, Peter, if you don't wash your feet, you can't walk with me. You know why? Peter don't have the ability to wash his feet.
Peter has to submit himself to Jesus so that Jesus can do it. Right? And the same thing with you and me. You don't have the ability to get yourself clean from the dirt of the day. So you know what you must do every day? Simply submit yourself to Jesus, confess your sins, and he washes your feet. And you can keep walking with him in fellowship. You follow me? So what two kinds of forgiveness are there in the Bible? Judicial and what? Parental. And we need both. Amen. If you're in this place today, you've never been born again. The Bible says you're condemned already. The judgment of God is already resting upon you. And you need to be born again by the Spirit of God. But for those of us who are Christians, what about the dirt of the day? The word, thoughts, deeds, and attitudes that keep us from walking in fellowship with him. Let's confess our sins. Amen. Father, we're thankful for the truth of your word. Thank you, dear God, that you have not left us to grope in darkness. Thank you for the blessedness, Father, that we can have as believers if we'd understand your word. That, God, not only do you give us righteousness, but you will not impute or charge sin. That's it sounds too good to be true, but it is true. And David said it, and Paul said it. But God, help us, like Abraham, to simply believe you. And God, so we wouldn't swag before you. Everything we have and everything we are, we have and we are because of your grace and your goodness. Help us to simply receive it by faith. Help us to walk in agreement with you. And God, help us always submit ourselves so that you might wash our feet. Confess our sins. In Jesus' name, amen.